Thank you for being with us here today. We conclude the evening with a panel discussion titled When Words Imitate Art, where we have Dr. Alka Pande, V. Sanjay Kumar, Sharmistha Ray, and Shanta Gokhale talk about the idea of the art novel, on how works and art, on how books and art inspire each other, and creating works of fiction centered around art. I shall briefly introduce our panelists. Dr. Alka Pande is the author of several books on Indian aesthetics, Indian erotic literature, and Indology, most of which have been translated into various languages. She was awarded the Australian Asia Council Special Award in 2009 and the Amrita Shergill Award in 2014 for her contribution to the arts by the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Academy. Alka is currently a consultant arts advisor and curator of the Visual Arts Gallery at the India Habitat Centre in Delhi. She has curated several exhibitions in India and abroad and played an instrumental role in working with upcoming artists, photographers, and sculptors. Our next panelist, V. Sanjay Kumar, grew up in Chennai and has worked with financial services in Bombay in the 80s before promoting a software venture to automate the banking industry. He now runs an art gallery and writes about art for various magazines and exhibition catalogs. Artist Undone, his work of fiction, takes place in Bombay, and The Third Squad, his forthcoming book, is set in Bombay of the 80s and the 90s. Shanta Gokhale, our next panelist, is a Bombay-based novelist, playwright, translator, theatre historian, and cultural critic. Her novel, Crowfall, translated from her award-winning Marathi original, Tyavarshi, was published in 2013. Shanta has also translated several Marathi plays into English and written screenplays for films and documentaries. She has edited the book, The Scenes We Made, published in November last year, which documents the ideas and people that shaped theatre in Bombay since the 60s. Sharmistha Ray, who will be moderating the session, is a visual artist with numerous solo shows and projects in India and abroad. She has worked on several art projects, including public works with various institutions and corporates. In 2013, she delivered a TED talk at the first official TED Fellows Retreat in Whistler, British Columbia. She is an art critic, an art writer, blogger, and the founder and curator of Bellevue Brunches and Salons, a popular mobile cross-cultural salon that aims to augment participatory modes of engagement with contemporary art. She is currently consultant for marketing and fundraising for the Kochi Biennale Foundation. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for staying back, I think, for the final session of the evening, When Words Imitate Art, Reimagining the Art Novel. I'm really lucky to be here with my illustrious panel. Thank you so much. And today we're going to be talking about not so much about the art novel, but really about how art making and art production, the world of artists, so to speak, and the art world with all its different machinations, has really captured the imagination, the literary imagination. And we're also going to be talking about, you know, certain aspects from a critical point of view, since Alka also comes from that space of writing critically about artists as well. And we want to explore some of the different themes, the different connections, the overlaps, and also the differences. And hopefully we'll also have some good arguments with each other. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Sanjay, who is going to be talking about this novel specifically. We've decided to talk about certain novels. They've all written several books. Talking about this book here, Artist Undone. So, Sanjay, would you like to talk about?
Like a good management graduate, I'll begin with the three C's. I was in Bombay in the 80s and worked very hard during the week. And on weekends, I would go to the Samovar restaurant at the Jahangir Art Gallery for biryani and beer. And this was an unfailing routine that happened week by week for 8 years. And in that time period, I never saw a single show. I got married, shifted to Chennai, and we were sitting and sorting out the gifts which people had given us. And there was one gift which was imperial size, and that was a work by M.F. Hussain. And the name was obviously something that rang a bell. And we were a little embarrassed, and we tried to ascertain what the value of this work was. And to do that, for the first time, we stepped into an art gallery in Chennai called Sarla's, because that was a name written behind on the frame, Sarla Framers. And we found it was a Banaras series serigraph, one of a limited edition, and the price was well within range of what a reasonable gift should be. But having stepped into that gallery, I was quite entranced by the show that was on the walls, and I bought my first work of art for 8,000 rupees, and it was a work by Jogen Chowdhury. So I would attribute my entry into the world of art to chance. The fact that somebody who saw nothing for 8 years in Bombay and then got into the business later is mere coincidence. And how would you describe a character who did something like this? I would call him a chutia. So those are my three C's which I carried with me to the book Artist Undone, where you had a character who saw a painting and he saw himself in that work and he felt he had to buy it. So there was chance in terms of his stumbling upon this work, and at that moment in life, at the point in time when he was in his midlife crisis, so to speak, he did something which was irrational and irreversible. His life was thereafter affected by his neighbor in Chennai, an artist who he never meets, but who turns his life topsy-turvy. I would attribute that to coincidence. And of course, he describes himself using the title of Nataraj Sharma's work, where he saw himself, which was fat, fucked, and 40. In Hindi, he called it Chalis, Charbi, or Chutia. So that is the connection that I had in terms of my entry point into writing about the art world. And in the 90s, I came back to Bombay, and I had a finance office in the Parel Mill compound, and we had a large gallery next door. My office was all of about 1,500 square feet, where we programmed software. The ceiling was 9 feet high, and the gallery ceiling height was about 50 feet, and it was all of 10,000 square feet. And at 7 o'clock in the evening, I would step across that divide from my office into the gallery. And for me, it was really a world apart. And it was this whole idea of an outsider stepping into the world of art and finding something puzzling, perhaps initially, and magical thereafter. And it was this basic theme that ran through this book about an outsider stumbling into the art world and discovering it on his terms. That in a sense is the origin of how I came about writing Artist Undone.
So you were telling me earlier that you've been in the art world since 1988. Do you still feel like an outsider? And are you required to also, in a sense, remove yourself and detach yourself? Because you are very involved in the art world. You're kind of involved with a very big contemporary art gallery. You know a lot of artists. You're personally engaged and involved. Does it require a level of a detachment from you? Do you sometimes still have to force yourself to be an outsider to that process in order to write?
I think the outsider hat I have now taken on in the world of literature, where I came in much later, so it's already in the last 6 years. So I still I don't have the feeling of A, being a creative person, and being an insider, so to speak, in the world of letters. As far as the art world is concerned, somehow for me, the idea of an outsider is if there is something still that you haven't understood, something that still puzzles you, something that still, a journey that still needs to be carried out. And I think for me, art still has all those qualities. There are two areas which fascinate me. One is art itself, the process of production and artists' lives. And the other is the art market. And while the former is something which puzzles most people, the art market particularly puzzles me because it goes against the tenets of all that I have learned of what markets are, what markets should be. And I think it's the art market is a slap in the face of all that capitalism stands for. If you were to really look at what markets should be efficient, mm-hmm. markets should be perfect, price setting should be rational, it goes against all those tenets. So for me, it's the last bastion of carpetbaggers and thieves, so to speak.
This idea of, you know, thievery and stealing is actually something that comes into your novel quite a lot. I mean, for those of you who don't know the novel, there's a protagonist, Harish Sinha, who actually buys this painting, has this kind of revelation in his life and wants to turn everything upside down and actually wants to move towards a semblance of the truth in his life. In the process, he loses everything, including his wife, to a con artist. So in a sense, this is all kind of Maya and illusion. But what's interesting is that for me, this idea of the con artist was actually a metaphor for stealing, in a sense, you know? And at the end of your book, I liked this, you know, paragraph. It says, all art is a form of thievery. We steal and we record it for all to see. The evidence is damning, for we sign our names with a flourish. You can stand before our wares and thread them bare. You will find associations, quotations, references, and hidden memories. There is enough to brand us for what we are. We are thieves. And of course, Picasso, I believe it was Picasso who had said that good artists copy and great artists steal. So can you comment a little bit about that idea of thievery and stealing? And of course, one of our famous artists, Subodh Gupta, also talks about thievery in his work and being a magpie and stealing.
I would agree with the term con artist, at least as far as the way I thought I wrote the character. Because the character is very, states very simply, his name is Newton, which is the middle name of Sousa. And he says, people start with a blank canvas. I start with the work of Newton. Why is it that so hard for you to understand? And so he says, people look for similarities. Why don't they look for the differences? So that's the nature of his practice. But and more than stealing or copying, I think it's a question. The question that is raised is, what is original? Is there something which is really truly original? And why is it a holy cow or a holy grail, this whole idea of originality, rather than perhaps a sense of an essential truth, which is what you really want to see in a work of art, that there's something which is truthful, there's something which is true to who the artist is really, as against trying to look for something which is new or original, which the newness seems to drive a lot of art practice today, you know, something different, something new.
And do you question that as a form of originality?
I don't take positions in the book. It is a work of fiction, so I think at one level, the issues are there and the characters play their role, and I really would leave it to the reader to experience it at that level rather than my saying something more about it.
Sure. So we'll come back. And now we would, Shanta, if you could talk a little bit about Crowfall. And this is really almost a postmodern fragmentation of a city kind of trying to come to grips with itself. At least that's the way that I read it in a nutshell. So I'd love for you to say a little bit about this.
Yeah. Uh, 1989 was for me a threshold of moving from a corporate job into a creative job. I was appointed arts editor with the Times of India. And for about 2.5 years, my life was full of the arts, visual, performing arts, architecture. All these things came onto my page. These artists were people that I had known earlier, because I had been looking at art. I was kind of almost brought up in theater. Music was a passion. So my friends belonged to the creative circles. And a lot of their problems, the issues that they faced in their creative process, were part of our conversations. And all of this found a focus when I started editing the arts page. It was an extremely critical moment, I think, from 1989 to 1992. when two things happened. There was a huge auction organized by the Times, and suddenly people who had no clue about the aesthetic part of art were seeing it as a business venture, collecting as investment, and politically and socially, it was also a time of great violence. 1986 was the year of the Rath Yatra and the trail of blood leading to Babri Masjid demolition, leading to Bombay riots. So somewhere in my mind, art and violence were two faces of this society. A whole lot of incidents triggered certain characters in my head. One was the suicide of a very young, very fine artist. And it was really a mystery. Why he did it, what happened, these details, I didn't know. Maybe an intimate circle of friends possibly knew. I didn't. But that's always a good space for a writer to be in, to know just this much and no more. So then you begin to create. Then you imagine a story. So actually, that story was to be the center of this novel. It is now marginal. It is Yogesh who kills himself. A whole lot of other things were flowing in. The minute I began to talk about art, artists, and creative process, I was also translating Prabhakar Barve's book, Kora Canvas, at the time. And his essays are entirely about his own creative process. So I had this vision of a blank canvas, which is a threat and a field of possibilities. So this canvas also became a central motif. Then, of course, my musician friends came in, and there was the contrast between a traditional art form, which is practiced within a given framework, and the visual arts, which were slowly moving out into a global world, and the creative processes involved with both. The musician fighting against the frame within which she has to practice, and arguing that to do something that she is convinced about is to take the tradition forward. So it was a problem between tradition and modernity, as far as musician was concerned. And with the visual artist, from painting into installations, video art, etc. So it was a time of change. And this is what I wanted to capture. And so novel ended up being a collection of narratives, all intertwined, but not a single protagonist as such emerging.
So why, when I was reading your book, the question came up to me is, what is it about artists and art making and production, which is so critical to the fabric of the kind of society that you're exploring? It's obviously a very important strata, you know, within this very complex and layered story that you're telling. And what was interesting to me is actually the contrast between the artist and the society of the spectacle, in a sense, and the artist's own struggle with that. And one of the most beautiful passages for me is when Ashish is actually standing in front of, you know, a blank canvas, and he feels this kind of terror of creation and what to create. And then on the other side, you have this kind of spectacle happening with the art market, with, you know, people selling out and exploitation and fakes and forgeries and so on and so forth. So what is it about that particular story that is so rich with possibilities in terms of telling a story like this?
You know, it's rather difficult, actually, to think back to how it started or how it worked out. As I said, there's a kind of a general plan in your head, and you start writing, and other things take over. And if your experience is grounded, then you can take these things on board and play around with them and see what emerges. So I wouldn't say that I had a very clear idea about many of the things that have gone into them. What was clear in my mind was violence, which is destructive, art, which is creative. And the creative person trying to live in a world which is dominated more and more by violence. So there is, for instance, that email which one of the artists writes to his group of artist friends. No, I can't see. But essentially, it is reporting on what has happened to a common friend of theirs who is an Iraqi, mm-hmm, and has been through two wars. And the question that the Bombay artists are kind of talking about is, how do we relate to violence, and how does it come, or should it come or not, into our art, and how? And here, this woman is saying, the first time that America invaded us, I thought that keeping a diary, a daily diary, and publishing it would make a difference, because it would tell people how we lived, how difficult it was. Mm-hmm. The second time around, 12 years later, which is the now of this novel, it's happening again. And this time she says, all I do is to put down my head and try and retrieve that little bit of humanity that is still within me, from which I create. I do my work. That's it. So this constant thing between destruction and creation was very much on my mind. And a lot of the stories came out of this kind of conflict.
Thank you.
Did I answer?
Yes, you did. In fact, I'm kind of itching to read that paragraph about the empty canvas, you know. It's would you mind if I read that?
Please.
Yeah. I'm a painter as well, so it's, you know, it's, these references to me also, of course, have a different maybe resonance. So the artist's name is Ashish, and he, of course, is also struggling with his daily life and battles and challenges, and also trying to create at the same time while living in this very kind of schizophrenic and postmodern city. So this kind of describes the moment when Ashish is standing in front of an empty canvas, which is something I do quite often as well. Ashish switches on the light. At once, the canvas standing on the easel leaps at him with a blank stare. It has been wordless for days. He has looked into its depths with pleading eyes, but not a single image has surfaced. It has remained a 2 by 1.5 feet of desert. The canvas is not at fault. He is. His imagination has deserted him. That thing called inspiration hasn't shown up. He's like slashed and burnt earth, no shoot or sprout in sight. He stands looking at the canvas with empty eyes, his mouth set. In the old days, he'd have panicked. Packed up time, he'd have told himself, you said you're an artist. Get yourself an art teacher's job in the old school in Surgao. He doesn't despair quite so easily now. He has come to terms with the waywardness of the creative spirit. He is willing to wait. I thought that was such a beautiful. So Alka, shall we move to you? And would you like to show your images and talk a little bit about your book, the double volume, which is called Voices and Images. It's edited by Alka, and there's two volumes in here. One is called Voices and one is called Images. And can I say that you come more from the critical perspective of actually documenting artist practice, interpreting it, and in that sense, you're more of a chronicler than a storyteller, I suppose. So would you like to start?
Well, you know, my journey to art actually started from Bombay itself. 81, I got married and moved to Chandigarh. I was raised in Delhi, was working here for radio and television, and also doing my first postgraduate degree in history from Kalina campus. And I go to Chandigarh, and it was in 81 a grey city, a Kubuzia city with concrete and glass and all that. And I registered for another MA. I did a MA in art history. I did my PhD, and I was teaching in the University Department of Fine Arts for 20 years. And in 1999, when I was head of my department and director of the Fine Arts Museum, I got the Charles Wallace Award to go to Goldsmiths College, where I did my postdoctoral work. Came back, by which time I was lucky enough to go back to the city where I grew up, which was familiar, and set up the visual arts gallery for the Habitat Center. It was a great time for me and the time that I was there, because having lived and worked and taught at the university for 20 years, it's like Krishna Solha Kalaon ke saath, you come back to the city where I grew up, and I set up a space which was really a space where it was a locus of cross-cultural dialogue. And I did the Documenta 11 platform, and Ranjit is here, he was there for it, and we did the Truth and Reconciliation panel with Okwi Nwizoa, who was now the Venice Biennale director. What was nice is doing these kind of things, I got an opportunity to set up a space which was a bit between the Barbican and the ICA in London, and it had a rental space where we were showing works. We were kind of providing a space. It's non-governmental. It doesn't have really any bureaucracy. And what I wanted to do was show an eclectic collection of artwork. It was not just the winners. It was a lot of people, like we show work of people coming from Indore, people coming from Chhattisgarh, and for people who just want to show and have a response. And one of the things which we felt, this is about 11 years ago, no, sorry, 13 years ago, photography had not yet become what it is today. So we set up an award. We were the first to set an award for photography, where we actually, what we do is, we just give about 2 lakhs of rupees, mm-hmm. putting the wind under the wing of the photographer, who is chosen on the basis of some work that he's done, and he's given a year to finish the project for which he's awarded. So that was one thing, and I wanted to just show some images, and my book The two books that I've done are really documenting 15 years of the visual arts. We bring out a journal every year, which is, again, a very critical space where it is theme-based. We've done it on photography, we've done it on design, we've done it on performing arts, because I truly believe that artistic practice is really about being intra and transdisciplinary. Mm-hmm. So the journals, each journal is theme-based. Also, it acts as a catalog of almost 140 exhibitions we do through the year in three of our spaces. We have an experimental space where the process of art is shown. We have an open space which is more of function and design, and the white cube of the visual arts. So these two volumes really are about that. And I just, if I could have the images, because this really is mapping the footprints of young photographers who have been awarded by us. And I just wanted to, I call this essay Outside In, Inside Out, The Great Indian Visual Journey. And I really believe that photography is a document, it is a recorder of truth, of history, of representation, of reality, and of multiple realities. And the very nature of the medium is democratic today. And as you see with your big posters here on selfies, everybody's a photographer. So at the Habitat, we also have been doing the Delhi Photo Festival. And now, at the end of this year, we are giving awards to four photographers on art and sustainable development. So we are looking at the process of making, because that's what I'm very, very concerned as an educator and as a person who's been in the service of the arts, to put that wind under the wings of artists and give them that little moment of takeoff. So for 5 years, I ran the Most Promising Artist Award with Art India. We also did the Emerging Artists for Ceramics, which we did with the Delhi Blue, and we are still continuing the process. And I just want to show you the work of these 11 photographers who we've awarded, what it was when they started and where they are today. Rishabh, can we just have the images, please? I'm sorry, I think you're a Shanta, you may not be able to see it. So we began in 2003. Next, please, if you'll just keep going through, Rishabh, just go to the next one. Yeah. This is, we began with Anay Mann, who lives in New Delhi. This is, we gave the award for his portfolio called A Generation in Transition in 2003. And today he's actually working on staged portraitures. Next, please. This is Sumit Inder Singh, who now lives in New York. He was awarded for the show called Beyond the Ramp. So it was all about the backside, other side of the fashion industry and catwalks, because he was working for India Today at that point. And he is now working on a documentation and documentary work in Peru at the moment. Next, please. This is Sandeep Biswas, who lives again in New Delhi. He was awarded for his portfolio called Reflections, and today he's also a documentary photographer, and he's working on a particular medical aspect of polio and children. Next, please. This is a very, very interesting photographer, Neeraj Mahajan, who lives in New Delhi. He was awarded on the Gypsies of India, and today he's working on products and still life. So he's gone from, you know, from critical photography to rotigraphy, in a manner of speaking. Next, please. In 2007, we gave it to a young photographer from Mumbai, Zubin Pastakia. He was kind of documenting and doing work on Mumbai, the idea of a city, and he's still continuing with Mumbai even now. So he's just following this through. Next, please. In 2008, we gave it to Samir Taude, again from Mumbai, and he's still continuing with documenting Mumbai. Next. Then Chandan Gomes, very interesting, began with very, very intimate kind, a philosophy student from St. Stephen's. He writes very, very beautifully on photography. He got an award for the LG for the unsung cubicle. And today he's working on sustainable development and invisible cities. He just showed in Delhi. Next, please. Then we had, we shared an award in 2010. Neha Masi, who lives in New Delhi and works with NDTV, she had worked with work in Assam, and she's still continuing with her work in Assam as an extension of the series on Assam riots. Next, please. This is, he shared the photography award with Niranjan, who lives in Bangalore, and he's working very interestingly with the communities in Gokarna. And his current series is a continuation of that work, but he's also looking at the body, the tattooing of the body as identity, very interesting work as well. Next, this is Akraditya Chakraborty. He was a winner in 2012. He lives in Tripura. He had worked on the crematoriums, very dark, very interesting work, and now he's working on a series in India and Bangladesh border. Very interesting work again. Next, please. This is 2015. We have Ashutosh, who lives in New Delhi, and his is a new project that he's working on. This is a project on tea leaves. So let's see where this work is going to take now. So this is just a one of the things, one of the volumes, which actually is mapping the whole trajectory of photography today, how the young are looking at the document of photography. And the other book is really a collection of the best of the 15 years of people who've written, people from India, people from outside India, how they are looking at India. It's more like a cultural studies reader rather than on visual culture. So I believe a lot in documentation. So I think everything, I'm a tireless documenter. So that's the way I kind of look at my work.
So in terms of, you know, you said for 15 years, this kind of covers 15 years of exhibition making, particularly in photography. What are some of the broad shifts that have taken place, not only in photography, which is still considered a newer medium, but just generally in the landscape of the art world or of contemporary art? And from someone who really has to constantly demystify the process of art making and kind of get behind the veil, and chronicle it and document it and, you know, at least kind of approach some form of truth. So what are the broad changes that you've seen?
That's a very loaded question, Sharmistha.
Well, I'm hoping we'll get into the same kind of exciting discussion we were
happening
earlier.
It may take me a whole evening to even talk about that, because I think that there is no just broad thing happening just now. India being such a plural country, having so many layers and traces of it, I wouldn't just say a broad thing, because there are a lot of things happening in the periphery. The kind of artwork which is emerging within the country has many, many layers. There is a metropolitan urban landscape where a lot of artists from big cities who are traveling, who are moving around, who are really looking at the digital and, you know, having access to a lot of media, they are producing quite a homogeneous, cosmopolitan international work. They're constantly vying with China and Chinese artists, and some are becoming bigger and scale because that's what China did. Some of them are just wanting to be taken in by Western curators and placed in, you know, they want a space in an international space, and they say, we are artists of the world. Then there are artists who are doing deeply spiritual work. There is calligraphy happening. There is what you call it, the vernacular, which is happening in a big way. There's a lot of indigenous art which is coming up. Mm-hmm. So what is very, very interesting is the cultural diversity which is present. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't say broad things, because if we are looking only at the white cube of the space, that's a different thing. There's a lot of public art happening. There's graffiti coming in Delhi at the moment, you know, which is very interesting, which takes me back to Basquiat and New York of the 60s and the 70s.
Do you see parallels happening, or do you think... you know, these are also independently a part of kind of the growth that is happening, the engagements that are happening as well, you know, or do you think that we're kind of paralleling, you know, movements and, you know, that have already happened in other contexts?
No, I think India's beautifully...
And, you know, feel free to jump into the conversation as well.
But I think India is beautifully peculiar, because a lot of people, I see a lot in Delhi, I'm talking of Delhi because that's the city I know best, I see a lot of... people from different countries of the world coming in. You know, we've got people from Latvia, from Poland. House cast is becoming really busy. They are painting on the walls. Shapur Jat is becoming another space where a lot of people from different parts of the world, which you least expect, are coming there to stay and create work. Also, what I see with Delhi in particular is, I wouldn't compare it to any other place, but maybe Mumbai and or Bombay, as I like to still call it, I don't know why, and New York have a little bit of a parallel. You know, the same kind of convergence, the same kind of different people here. It's a melting pot. There are so many languages which are being spoken here. Delhi is deeply political, and it has a different sensibility. It has, you know, certain things, the typical thing of Jinne Lahore Ni Vekha or Jamia Nahi, you know, that whole thing with their preoccupation with Punjab. It's very different. I mean, it's political, it's interesting, it's very vibrant, definitely.
So coming, you know, you're talking about now multiple art practices, and I'd like to come back to both Shanta and Sanjay's books, and this was a question I had asked you earlier as well, is that, you know, there's so much, there's a multiplicity, you know, there's real pluralism of art practices happening, you know, and in fact, if there's kind of one way of looking at things, you know, we kind of brand it as the modern identity, you know, this kind of, this idea of a pure engagement, or, you know, the artist as being kind of inherently pure or representing culture in a sense. But it's interesting to me, and especially, you know, for you, Sanjay, as well, is that, you know, you come from the art world as well, and you've seen such a diversity of practices. Why painting, you know? Because, I mean, even across other kind of books that I've read in which the art world and artists are, you know, used as kind of, you know, as part of the text or subtext, is that, you know, painting seems to provide these kind of possibilities. And I wanted to know why you chose to kind of write about, you know, painters specifically.
It just happened that I chose a painter as a protagonist. And I think it was also a time period when painting, the story was probably set at a time period when painting was the primary medium. And of course, things have changed thereafter. And I mean, just to take off from what she said, for me, the significant change over the past few years has been the emergence of the curator and how important the curator has become in terms of the discourse itself. And perhaps how curators are also influencing art practice in ways that we did not imagine. So there is that interesting change as well that has happened. In terms of media, I think, yes, art has jumped off the wall and it has taken different forms. Perhaps in a future narrative, I may be looking at artists who are practicing differently. I don't think for me it's that material that writing about art or writing fiction, which is a narrative, should be aligned to painting, which can be a narrative. I mean, it could be video. I mean, it's not so much narrative being present in art, which aids you or abets you in terms of coming up with a narrative in your writing. I don't think really there is necessarily a link. Mm-hmm. It's more to do with the broader concerns of what art is, what art does, perhaps rather than the medium itself.
Forgotten what you asked. Never mind. I'll answer anyway. I think microfall is very clearly and specifically grounded in Maharashtra. Maybe you don't realize it when you're reading it, but it was originally written in Marathi, and I was addressing a reader who would know where I was coming from. Mm-hmm. As I said, a lot of artists were talking in those days about a lot of problems that they were having with where to go, what kind of art to practice. And one of the triggers was a man, an artist, who just come out of the JJ school. He belonged to a farming family, and he was telling me about how difficult it was to get his family to allow him to come to Bombay and do something called art. What was it? Like Sudarshan Shetty once told me that his parents, middle class parents, didn't understand this business of art and why he should want to do it. And there was this magazine with Hebbar on the cover. On the cover, mind you, of a magazine. So he said to his parents, look, that's where artists can go. And it's a story. He tells it well. But the point is that something as concrete as that turned his parents' opinion, and he was allowed to try out art. This man that I'm talking about, who had struggled and fought and come here, and he said, I love painting. I've done it from the time I was a child. And now I step out of school and find painting is no longer valued. It's all about installation and video. And I don't even know what it is, leave alone feeling that I can do it. And should I? Should I not? He was completely confused, then stuck to painting, didn't bother about. So, and he's from Kolhapur.
This artist that you're talking about?
Yes, yeah. The real artist.
Okay.
And there's an imaginary one, okay, who comes from Kolhapur. And of course, his trajectory is a little different because, of course, that's fiction. But this was a very real issue. In Maharashtra, there is also a very, very strong romantic idea of art, that it is something that pleases the eye, and it is beautiful in the romantic sense of beauty, pretty colors, pretty, and recognizable objects. A tree is a tree. A man is a man. And this is an extremely strong background. And in some of the artists that we speak of with immense respect are people who have also done paintings for chocolate boxes. And there are streets named after them. So, in a sense, I was talking to a people who have this sort of notion about art and about artists who are those people with long hair, bohemian lifestyles, and who are really actually not real human beings at all. So it was within that kind of context that also this novel got. So it's culturally, I think, very specific.
Well, you answered the question really well, and the questions I didn't ask as well, so thank you. So what are some of the problems or challenges that you have all faced, you in the literary domain and you in terms of being this chronicler over 15 years? I mean, do you feel, you know, sometimes our society is ruptured by major occurrences that happen which we didn't, you know, expect, world crises, natural calamities, etc., you know? Are you forced to kind of draw forward certain themes? Have new themes emerged? So that's my question to you specifically. And for you both, it's, you've also talked about some of the problems and challenges, but, you know, specifically kind of the problems and challenges of writing about, you know, and fictionalizing art in a sense.
Can I go first?
Yes, absolutely.
This problem has been so painful for me. See, back to this romantic tradition where a well-known Pune artist has been quoted as saying, what is painting? It's inspiration. When it comes to you, you just do a stroke and another, and that's your painting. So now, if I am trying to talk about artists and their work, I need to do something very concrete, which means I need to imagine paintings that don't exist. So this work, there are two or three works which I'm talking about in great detail, and they're not out there as objects. And I'm scared stiff because I'm not a painter and I don't know what the hell I would be doing had I been a painter. And here I am talking about actual works.
Can you describe what one of those works, or just...
Oh my God.
Yeah.
There's this one which stumps Ashish, which begins with an accident of the bars of a window falling on the canvas, mm-hmm. and creating two triangles. And he decides, since he is not being inspired, he will just take this as a starting point. Very often, an artist just puts a mark on the canvas, and that becomes a starting point. So, but through the book, he has to complete this painting. What do I do?
Did you have a case study of...
No, I had nothing except my own imagination, if I may call it that. But my solution was to write what I thought he would do. And I sent that chapter to Sudhir Patwardhan. I said, please to read and please to tell whether such a work of art can be produced by an imaginary artist. And he came right back and he said, look, you have started off with a problem that is graphic. You've got two triangles. What the way that you've developed that painting up to a point belongs to this idea. But somewhere you've kind of not actually formulated it. You need to actually formulate it in terms of graphics. So the faces that I've put into that painting come as circles and oblongs and whatever. So that space is filled with this crowd of faces, but the trigger is graphic. That was his suggestion. So it was very painful. But I had to stick with this. Like the musician, I had to stick with the idea, stick my neck out mm-hmm. and imagine or compose a bandish mm-hmm. which fell into a certain tal, which belonged to a certain rag and mood, because this was the bandish that the singer was going to sing. And my validation there is that my friend Neela Bhagwat sings that bandish, which I composed, and I'm not a composer.
Thank you.
In terms of writing something on the art world, I like you guys to imagine, those who are not familiar with the art world, that somebody pays 23 crores for an artwork called Birth. Now, that's enough money to set up a maternity hospital. Imagine somebody comes up with an artwork which, over a period of time, disappears. It's an amorphous form placed and it disappears. And imagine a collector actually buys that work. Imagine somebody called Richard Prince in the US who takes jokes of the internet, laser cuts it on pieces of board and sells it in an edition of 8 of 10. Imagine Richard Prince taking Marlboro ads from a magazine, removing Marlboro, blowing up that ad, and that sells the first photograph that sold for $1 million. Now, when real life is so fascinating and interesting, the biggest challenge is actually to make a narrative, a fictional narrative out of it, which remains interesting. I think that was principally a challenge that I had. The other issue basically was in terms of the language. Art discourse can be dense, so the challenge was to keep the narrative at the tone of the narrative mm-hmm. Really as that of an outsider. I mean, I knew enough about the art world and so on, but how to keep it at a level of an outsider gradually getting to know the art world. So that was a significant challenge for me as well.
Okay. Well, I've been informed we have just 5 minutes left, and I was going to get into a very interesting discussion about the periphery that we were talking about. You were, but would you like to also kind of have a go at this question about some of the problems and challenges you face, not in the fictional space, but, and maybe we can end on that note.
Well, I don't know if there are any problems. It's been very interesting to watch the journey of contemporary art in particular, because we've got these moments happening. You know, when you look at pre-modern India and you see that it was a sculptural India. When you look at medieval India, you see a kind of a text image thing happening where artists were more like illustrators illustrating manuscripts. Then you come to modernity and you see a kind of a different thing happening. And that's a thing which really needs to be still kind of talked about a lot. And I think Arsha's done this very interesting show called The Bitten Knight, which is from, you know, which is addressing some part of it. But you know, from in the contemporary, what I find is that at this moment in particular, there is a certain amount, for me, I'm talking from my personal narrative, I find a certain kind of sterile atmosphere. There's a sterility which is happening. I think there's going to be a second coming. The new generation of artists who are looking at gender, at sexuality, politics of identity. I think this new generation is going to come up with something really very interesting. We've had a certain upsurge. There is this certain, you know, it's like when you are leaving a soil fallow, things are happening and there are lots of things happening. So I think modernity is one issue which we really need to reread and look at, and I'm waiting for this second coming literally of a new kind of language, which is going to be a very strong language. I'm kind of waiting for it.
And on that bold note, I think we can wrap up, unless there's any kind of final comments that anyone wants to make. Thank you for this wonderfully engaging discussion, and thank you everyone for being here. Thank you.